how big they can grow, how quickly they can grow. So if we can offer a way of offsetting some of these over time, and based upon the actual proficiency and performance of the individual business, like a retail business, only looking at something coming from the new retail taxes that they generate. I think that's what you were asking for correctly. The guidelines themselves, I mean, it's almost 2.5 pages, pretty easy to read. I assume everyone's had a chance to go through this. And instead of spending like the lateness of the day, I just soon answer any questions first and foremost. I think that'd be best. Someone is here that would like to speak to this, to maybe give you a real life.
Would you like that to be part of your presentation before we go to council questions? I think that would make sense. Okay, I'll give, why don't I, since you're here and you've traveled a bit and you've stayed a while, we'll give you up to, we'll view you as part of the presentation up to 5 minutes. Okay? I know, that's why I gave you five.
Good evening. My name's Jack Mandel. I'm a senior site development manager with Lowe's Home Improvement. We're based in Carlsbad, California. I've been with Lowe's about a little over 11 years and covering 12 Western states. Fortunately, I still have a job with Lowe's. As you know, most big retailers have pulled back drastically on growth, as has Lowe's. A couple of years ago, we were, I think it was 2007, we opened about 150 stores in the 50 United States. The following year, we were projected to do 160. We were on that path, and then the recession hit. This year, we're on track for about 20 to 30% of that, and who knows what next year holds. So the moral of that story is that our real estate committee is being very selective now on where we choose to locate a new store. I've had several projects that were in the mill, had the rug pulled out from under them completely just because it didn't make sense in these economic times to open a store that was maybe in a market that already had other stores that we would just cannibalize. But Salinas is one of these lucky ones, I would say, that our real estate committee is very concerned about, I mean, are very interested in, but they're concerned about cost. Obviously, what they're looking for are the good deals right now. And Salinas has some pretty significant impact fees. I would say in the projects I've been involved with, the traffic impact fees are among the highest. Not to say question whether or not that's fair, but if there are opportunities for incentive, I can at least give you some assurance that this, it will make the likelihood of this project moving forward much higher than if not. We're in the due diligence and inspection phase right now. We're gathering all the information on cost, on time, on process, and we still have to take this back to our real estate committee for one more round of approval. If it doesn't look good, it probably won't move forward. And one of the ways, I think probably the most significant way, is the dollars. If we come in and say, here's what we gathered, but here's what we've worked out in partnership with the city of Salinas to do, and we're going to realize a significant savings, I think that will go volumes to getting this project moved forward. So I really encourage you to do what you can to implement these economic incentives, and I'm not blowing smoke here. It's reality. Every project it seems to be hanging by a thread. I was working on one in Southern California, and just last week they just put it on hold. They stopped it, and it's who knows when it'll go back. And I really see this opportunity here as being a good one. I know Lowe's would be very happy to be here in Salinas, but we need to make this a workable deal, and I encourage you to help us do that.
Good. Well, don't go far. We want you to get your 4 hours money's worth.
Okay, so, thanks.
Council may have questions for you. Okay, any questions from council? Tony?
Mr. Weir, in listening to this gentleman, do we know what Lowe's is asking for at this time?
Councilmember Barrera and members of the council, no. We have an idea of a range of cost considerations, but until you would adopt these policies, then they actually have a framework to actually make a request, which would then be analyzed very carefully. I mean, I know what I've been told. Whether that's a real number or not, we'd have to find out. But it is in the range of, or I should say, this policy would allow you to address, I think, what their concerns are.
Okay. Janet.
We want you here too, so. But my question is, on this chart that you gave us, I didn't see anything, any cities that actually use the sales tax as one of the incentives.
There, I have a list of cities that do. The unfortunate part of that is it's such a massive amount of information. And actually, Ari just introduced me to an opportunity to survey all the cities that I just didn't know the tool is out there. And we're getting a lot of responses. So I can have a lot more information. I mean, I actually have stuff in my bag if you want me to. But there are many, many cities that do offer various kinds of ways of doing this. Some use sales tax, some use rebated, some use loan forgiving for facilities development. It's just all over the place. And that's one of the things, while I have the opportunity, Councilmember Barnes, is what I know from my experience is you need to adopt whatever works for you. It should not be what works for everyone else, because every place is separate and different. It should make sense for you. The one thing that I want everyone to clearly understand is if you adopt this, it's a policy. You can use it if you choose or not. You can change it at any time if you want. The whole purpose of this is to give you something that is defined. So if someone comes and makes a request, we know exactly what should be done and in the way it should be done before we bring anything to you. That's the whole purpose of this. You're not obligated in any way, if someone makes a request, to say yes. The decision has to stand on its own merits.
Well, don't you think we should also be talking to some of the other fee inducers, like the county and TAMSI and all? Should we be the only ones that are giving incentive?
We have already, in the past, when given the opportunity and identifying the need, have gone to agencies like TAMSI. We did this for drive-through restaurants. May sound a little bit like, why would we do that? Their fees were so high for a drive-through restaurant like a McDonald's that each operation by itself would be almost $650,000. We've got those fees reduced by 90%. That is applying everywhere throughout the entire county, because the way they had calculated it, our engineering folks who have done traffic analysis and many were able to sit down and share with them a better, more intelligent way to do it. We'll do that with every applicant. We're planning on doing that at every time that we can. We just need to have the information. We've already talked to, in this case, Lowe's, about the number of travel trips and everything. They already know people that are in Salinas that are shopping somewhere else. They can tell us that exactly. So that should save us actually going to TAMSI and saying, you know, you should be able to reduce certain by this amount. They're not going to be leaving. They're not traveling. We know they're going to stay inside the city. And most of the folks inside the city do not use TAMSI routes. They use our city streets. So yes, we should go forward. I don't know what to do with the county. I think if there's any fees, wastewater treatment fees, can, you know, any of those things, we actually try to sit down and talk to all the different agencies and see what we can do.
Yeah, I believe that should be part of the process when you're doing negotiations.
Okay.
Jill.
I really appreciate it, that, Jeff, when you're talking about that this is a potential use of incentives. And my concern is we're looking at property tax, which we only keep a little over 13% collected. Sales tax, we keep a penny and a half. So those are the kind of, where those are very limited resources for the city, and yet some of our very few revenues for the city. So if we can be pretty flexible in terms of, you know, how we work that out. I guess you're saying this is really just a toolbox that we can use and be very flexible.
Right. It offers a matrix of choices, so you can use any or all or none.
And one other question then, and thank you. The other question I have, and it does regard Lowe's, and we really are excited about you coming here, regarding those traffic impact fees, is that part of this that we can negotiate? And the reason I ask is because, and I might be wrong on this, but it seems to me that Lowe's is being charged traffic impact fees based on the entire project when completed, and that's a project that's not going to even start for years and years to come. So can we adjust those fees, reflecting the fact that the economy has pretty much come to a standstill and that future growth area will not be built out for a long time?
I would offer an approach that could work. The normal traffic impact fee in the city of Salinas is $301 per trip.
Okay.
If you're in the future growth area, it's $437. I don't believe Lowe's is here in anticipation of future growth here.
No.
I think they're here because of the market already here. We could look at how could we offset those differences over a 5-6 year period based on the new revenues that are generated, based on delaying or deferring payments until certain things are satisfied. There's a variety of choices you could make there to allow them to go, look, even though this is a number ultimately gets paid in some form or fashion, we're only going to be producing so much. That keeps intact the impact fee structure, because you need to be very careful. If we start fooling with impact fees per se, you get this and you get that, and you might put the whole thing in jeopardy. So I wouldn't see, that's why I've tried to say in there, these are non-impact fees. The impact fees need to get paid. It's how they get paid is what we can really discuss.
Okay.
So that gives you flexibility. And by the way, you work all that out with them in partnership. It either works or it doesn't. And then you can make the decision of, okay, we can accept this or not.
Okay, good. But I do hope that we can still, I understand what you're saying about the impact fees, and we don't want to start, you know,
right,
tugging them and moving around. But that is a rather unique situation in that area, because Lowe's, I believe, was going to, we had anticipated come in at about the same time as all the housing. And the housing, while it is coming in, it certainly will not be in for as quickly as we thought it would be.
True.
So let's be flexible.
Yes.
Thank you, Jill. Steve, okay. All right, any public comment? Okay, back to council. Sergio.
You did it. You know, for the years that I've known you, we've been talking about this, because Guanajuato's been doing it for a long time. Mexico's doing it for a long time. A lot of countries are doing it. A lot of cities are doing it. So I'm glad that we're getting in that direction. And I'm just wondering if there's additional things we can do to bring business into Salinas or retain more business and people that create jobs and all that, mm-hmm. help them with, you know, recruitment and training and really getting our population ready for those jobs as we start attracting people. So I'd be interested if there's additional, and maybe from the gentleman from Lowe's, if there's other kind of sweet deals or incentives that you have received from other cities that we can continue to, you know, put into this toolbox. I think it's important to have that as people approach us, because the way it's been is somebody's there and kind of we react to it versus proactively be able to say we can offer you this many incentives, you know, so there's an array of different things that they can choose and pick as they feel it's needed. So great job on this, but I would like to see if there's any other additional incentives that we can consider that you get in other cities.
Mayor, would you like?
Sure.
Okay. Yeah.
Sure. I can cite several examples, not a lot, unfortunately, in California. As the economy was booming, a lot of times we were going to cities, and the cities were saying, what are you going to give us for the privilege of building a Lowe's store here? And that's just the way the economy was back then. You know, there were several other big boxes or large retailers vying for the same property we were vying for, and so there was really no reason for them to give incentives. We were cutting, I cut a huge deal in Lake Havasu, Arizona for Lowe's a few years ago, where we got almost $2 million worth of incentives because there were quite a bit of public improvements that needed to go on. The city use some grant money they had and use some other sources of funding to offset. Like I said, it was about almost $2 million, $1.9 million. Colorado, we've did Fort Collins, Loveland, Greeley, all gave us economic incentive packages. Westminster, Colorado, outside of Denver, all of those projects I worked on were very large, of different varieties. And I'm happy to hear you're saying be flexible and let's have a tool.